communities here in India. Quite often, we think about privacy violations as an abstract form of being which only impacts people with digital devices. But the impacts of privacy and its deprivation are most severely felt by communities who lack economic and social power in our society. I won't speak more on this because we have the authors here, all of them, most of them, in fact, with us. And let me just introduce you to them one after the other. So, the essay which we'll be discussing today, much more broadly, because we also know that some of you who are joining us may not have had a chance to read it, will be by Ameya Bokel, Avinindran Khare, Nikita Sonavane, Srujana Bej, and Vaishali Janarthan. Janarthanan. So I'm sorry, I've messed up all of your names, I think so. The title of the essay is Settle Habits, New Tricks, Casteist Policing Meets Big Tech in India. So when I read this essay, and I'll just then turn this over to them, the essay starts from a vivid description of the station house officer at Kolar Road Police Station in Bhopal. And the authors write, "It is the evening of 15 June 2019. The station house officer of the Kolar Road Police Station in Bhopal, the capital city of central Indian state of Madhya Pradesh, convenes his officers to announce a rise in car thefts in their jurisdiction. He states that the thieves are the local pardis and instructs officers to make nighttime visits to the Pardi Basti, a slum colony, and pick up and detain anyone outside after dark. This goes unchallenged because the police widely believe that the Pardis are habitual criminals, responsible for every case of housebreaking and theft. We may have found it hard to believe that the police blatantly target an entire community had we not been at the station for an entirely different reason." So this opens it up to Nikita. Nikita, what was the reason you were there?
So we were there because one of our clients, who's a young man from the Gond community, which is not a Vimukta community, but is an Adivasi community that's targeted by the police, had actually been detained for theft, and he had been detained for theft of temple bells. They said that there have been thefts of temple bells that are happening across the city of Bhopal. And as is routine, the law says, of course, that the moment you arrest an accused person, you're required to produce them before the magistrate in less than 24 hours. But this is honored more in breach. So he was being detained at the police station for nearly 2 days. And when we were at the police station trying to negotiate and at least get the police to produce him before court, is when we saw that, these sort of discussions and like these sort of orders were being issued, because they assemble in the morning and there are these and this is a part of the police training, right? This is what we witnessed is just a reiteration of what is a part of the police training and a crucial part of it, which is to say that there are certain communities that are criminals by birth, that are habitual offenders, and therefore they need to be subjected to surveillance, patrolling. And every police station in their jurisdiction must keep an eye on these basties where these communities reside. Apar, you're on mute.
Which brings me to a much larger question about the essay itself. Based off this experience, do you think this is a one-off instance? Because you go on to also explain the larger background, Vaishali, Avindra, Srujana. I would like to ask you and invite you into a wider conversation around this also. How this ties in possibly with the Criminal Tribes Act, and I think Gautam, who may be tuning in for this telecast also, did a fantastic thread, I think so, once on Meena Radhakrishnan's book
Oh,
called
yeah.
Dishonored by History. So the act is gone, or is it still there? And what's the background behind it? And how does it relate to tech? We'll get to that in a while. But I want these foundations to be very fleshed out and tangible for people in terms of the policing experience in Bhopal and Madhya Pradesh.
Right, yeah. So, well, just as you said, this is not a one-off incident. This is something that's been historically around forever. And what's important to realize about the history of the police in India is that it functions now, more or less, in the same manner that it has in the past, right? The Indian police was constituted in the wake of the 1857 revolt. It's modeled after the Royal Irish Constabulary. And its functions or its sort of purpose in India is largely the same, which is to control by force an insurgent nationalist population, right? Except in India, to streamline the operation, so to speak, what happens is that there's a consensus that builds around who is to be targeted by this newly minted police force. And this consensus is informed by the caste system, right? And it's this rather potent cocktail of these racial anthropological theories of criminality that are in vogue in Europe at the moment. And this idea of heritability that is in some ways inherent to caste itself, right? And they sort of collude and find expression in the Criminal Tribes Act, which is a series of legislations. The first one comes out in 1871, and this sort of brands entire communities as criminals. And consequences follow, such as reporting one's movements to authorities, to being ghettoized in reformatory settlements and so forth.
Can I quickly just come in for just reading or two passages from Dishonored by History, which demonstrate what was the form of surveillance?
Right.
So I'm quoting from the book, rules regarding surveillance under the Criminal Tribes Act stipulated that a member of a criminal tribe could not leave the village temporarily or permanently unless they had obtained a certificate from the headman. On arrival in another village, they had to present themselves to the headman there and present themselves and show the certificate to prove their credentials. One man, and then there's a quote also, which has been extracted in this Twitter thread. One man in our settlement in Gorakhpur has been flogged 15 times, another 6 times. They are both happily now working in the Salvation Army factory. So it'll also be interesting to know, what was there a concept of forced labor under this? And I hope you address that a little later, going from the questions of surveillance.
Well, I'm not particularly aware of the aspect of forced labor, if that existed. But it definitely did curb movement in very large terms. It did curb what you could do. It was in some ways, a sort of historical antecedent to the kind of surveillance that is seen of the Mimukta communities today. And Vaishali will touch on it more when she gets to the research that we did and the field surveys that we conducted. But what we realize now that is what happens after independence in 47 is that there's a committee that's constituted. It considers the question of the criminal tribes and it calls for the repeal of the act, right? And in 1952, the tribes are denotified. Except the moment that happens, almost simultaneously, you have this category of the habitual offender come up. In some states, it comes in through full-fledged legislation. In most other places, it's part of the executive police rules and regulations that are in place. One of the Madhya Pradesh jail manual that we cite in our piece explicitly recognizes denotified communities as potential habitual offenders. And while in many other places, though the explicit expression of the the caste-based nature of surveillance and oppression is gone. Since the police is the same and the institution is the same, the burden of the surveillance and the oppression that that the category of the habitual offender facilitates is still on the same communities that were victimized by the Criminal Tribes Act, right? So, and the category of the habitual offender is A, nebulously defined, B, gives vast discretionary power to the police in terms of what they can do for surveillance, right? So the MP police regulations allow for picketing in front of houses, domiciliary visits at night, give very wide powers for the police to keep track of a habitual offender's repute, jobs they have, places they go to, people they meet. And in some ways, and through the network of MUKBIs, which are police informants, it sort of keeps an eye on basically the entire sort of course of a habitual offender's life. And it has a network's effect in that once they have their eye on one individual, through their associates, so through the people that they meet or the people that they go to have jobs with, they can keep track of the history of an entire community, right? And that's how the habitual offender today is sort of a direct descendant of the individuals that were criminalized by the Criminal Tribes Act. So, and the sort of pervasive and comprehensive extent of the surveillance is something that Vaishali will throw more light on. And
before we shift, I just had a small question, which may be also of interest at a subsequent point in time, as you may develop this research further. Given that its core focus is towards surveillance, under what provisions of the CRPC are the habitual offenders lists created, and what are the protections as well? Because certain jailhouse manuals, even in the British era, have certain requirements for protection of prisoner information, which are gathered. So is there anything which parallels that here? And I think if it's completely absent, given its impact, what can be a good data protection lens as well to look at it as an objective of criminal law reform?
Well, I mean, more than that, I mean, one thing that I think I should sort of let you know is that in terms of when we did our research and when we met with policemen and we were conducting interviews and so forth, even if there are provisions, one of the things that you notice almost instantly is the lack of any concern with legality in how the police sort of conducts itself. So a large number of times we found that policemen, for instance, did not know where or how a habitual offender is defined, right? And part of it is that there is no definition, obviously. But I mean, a starker sort of sense that we got was that in some ways the police does not, it's a non-question in some ways, right? It's not something that is that they think is important. It's something that it's the legality of it is not something that one concerns with in some ways, right? The opacity of these records or how habitual offenders are recognized or how the police keeps track of them is something that they do for administrative efficiency, administrative expediency, right? But it doesn't have, there's no aspect of protection or there's no aspect of engaging with the individual in question, right? It's more in the interests of the police to guard these registers very very closely and sort of keep their cards to their chest. But I mean, we did not find that there was anything that A, went on to protect habitual offenders, anything explicit, but also in some manners, even if that was there, we definitely didn't think that the police were either aware or concerned with the legal provisions that concern.
Also, just to add to what Avi is saying, which is that these registers that are maintained, that are purely maintained in line with, for instance, in MP, it's in line with the MP police regulations, right? So these are delegated pieces of legislation that allow for these registers to be maintained. Now, of course, what kind of information goes into that register is up to the discretion of the police, right? Which means that in MP, for instance, the register also includes information about family members, because they say they think that it's important to do that from a deterrence point of view. So that information about family members, friends, etc., all of that is also recorded in these registers. So from a criminal law data protection point of view, what we're looking at is that we're looking at that sort of criminalization of entire communities, right? And now, of course, with digitization, I mean, so far this information was only stored within the institution of policing. But now with digitization, there is, of course, a very palpable risk of that information flowing freely between other branches of the criminal justice system also, right? Which is, of course, the judiciary. So then the question to be asked is, what does it do to the question of the principle of innocent until proven guilty or a free and fair trial? Because accused persons don't know what kind of information is there that exists. And this is information that is very carefully guarded and is just moving, you know, between different arms of the state, or will, if this information is digitized. So that is the risk that we are looking at, is this really like this perpetuation of criminality of communities at large.
Nikita, I just want to make this a bit more tangible based on your own writing.
Yeah.
So there's this excellent article linked within your essay called Why Charan Singh Bolts His House From Inside Out, right? And that's on Article 14. We'll be providing a link of all these readings later as well to demonstrate the substantial basis of work which has already been undertaken by several of the authors here to demonstrate not only the tech integration, but the casteist nature of policing and how it's inputting into that based on legal ambiguity. So right before we come to you, Vaishali, I'm sorry for taking this time, but I'll just read out what has been written. This article in its abstract is, what if you had a wedding and must submit an invitation and list of outstation guests to the police? ? And in a paragraph there, this legal ambiguity itself is stated with reference to the prison manual, if I'm not wrong. Just give me a second, please. In Madhya Pradesh, and I quote, in Madhya Pradesh, police regulations are more ambiguous. Criminal history does indeed matter, but even those who are not convicted of crimes might be viewed as habitual criminals if the police station house officer has quote unquote reasonable suspicion. Rule 411, subclause 4 of the Madhya Pradesh prison manual defines a habitual offender as also being, in quotes, a member of scheduled tribes in the jurisdiction of the state government according to their discretion. And this, as both Ameya and Nikita write in their article, has tremendous impacts in policing by itself. I'm so sorry, Vaishali, for holding up this transition to you, but these are having real impacts, and we'll be circulating these readings subsequently as well, which describe in vivid detail the tangible harms which occur from present policing practices. But Vaishali, much more excited to learn also how this is just being scaled up, as they say in the tech sector, towards another new paradigm of dangerous injury and disruption in a much more distressing manner.
Yeah, Thanks, Apar. And I will continue to lay out how the stigma of criminality plays out in the everyday lives of the people we interviewed here. So I also want to start out by flagging out, like we're going to lay out a gist for you. But we want to flag out that among the authors, some of us are from the Bahujan community and some of us are from the upper caste community, but none of us are from the Vimukta community. Vimukta Jati, meaning liberated communities, is the term of self-assertion by the denotified tribes, often referred as DNT. Just laying out these things for all the audience also who may be new to these terms. Vimuktas also include nomadic and semi-nomadic Adivasi communities who do not ascribe to the caste system but are persecuted by it. And this essay in today's panel is based on CPA Project's work on the issue of the historical and present day targeting of the Vimukta community in Bhopal by the police and the criminal justice system. And for this essay that we wrote for the TNI State of the Power report, we interviewed members of the Parthi tribe and the Irani Muslim community, both historically criminalized communities, and also visited police stations and interviewed police officials of all ranks, right, to get a sense of how do they view these tribes and how they think their duties are, right? So the Parthis were part of hunter-gatherer semi-nomadic tribes, and there are several subdivisions based on where they usually lived or what they did. How their mobility was controlled by the CTF, which is the Criminal Tribes Act, has already been laid out by Avi, and he will be speaking more on that later. And this served the British administration and the upper caste zamindar as well, right? But what I want to focus on right now is the stigma of criminality and what it happens. Like you mentioned from that article itself, we also came across many more instances. For a 21-year-old Parthi law student that we interviewed, his first experience of visiting a police station and being in a lockup with his father was at age 8, right? Like that's how young it starts. And a common practice that the police follow is to beat the parents in front of the child under the garb of sending a deterring message, right? So it's like with this violence, they also make the parents admit crimes they've not committed. And this is a sort of psychological trauma that a Parthi child grows up with. And what can land a Parthi in a police station, right? If he asks that, it is literally anything. Like, just think about this. If I were to ride a motorcycle without a helmet and I was caught by the police, I'm at most going to have to pay a fine, chalan katega, and if I can't manage this off in a small bribe, right? But a young Parthi man can end up being booked for theft for the same incident. And because when he's stopped, he's also interrogated about the price of the bike, when he bought it, how did he manage to afford it, and then can be dragged to the police station, which has happened. And because of this, Parthis are constantly reevaluating their daily movements and activities, which can be as banal as going to drink tea, going for a walk, going to fish, or like you mentioned, for weddings, because everything is watched and anything can be used against you. So this is the state of anxiety and stress that comes with the constant risk of incarceration that they face. And during our interview itself, I want to point out, we held it in an open space. We're all on the ground sitting, informal sort of setting. One of the members casually mentioned that, "Dekho, ye aaj apni meeting jo hai, iski khabar police ko pahunch jayegi." Like, this is how pervasive and intrusive the surveillance is out of their everyday life. The Parthis, like other Vimukta communities, have been long dispossessed of their traditional means of livelihood. Now, when we're discussing how it impacts all different aspects of their life. So having lost because of other acts like the Wildlife Protection Act, they've not been able to hunt, and they are now relegated to daily wage labors, waste picking, unloading rubble, clearing bushes, and even begging. And even while carrying out work, women are harassed and threatened with charges. Sexual harassment and torture by police is not uncommon for women in this community. And there is hardly any hope for economic stability, because no one offers steady employment. Like, this was a common thing we heard, kaam dega kaun? Right? Like, they hear the name, and this is how like caste continues to play that burden while the police enjoy impunity. And the police extortion can start anywhere from 30,000 to 1 lakh. And what does this depend on? This depends on how many times have you been framed before by them. So it's like they have their own scale at which they can extort people. And even bail amounts are absurdly disproportionate to the charges. Yes, even judges are quite insensitive when they slap such bail amounts. And this is part of the work we do as lawyers at CPA, is to provide quality defense to these communities. And we will be speaking more about that as well. I just want to end this part by saying that the exploitative nature of criminalizing communities by their caste is summarized in this brazen admission by the police that one of the interviewees told us. Ki, tum sudhar jaoge to hamari kamai kaise hogi? You know, so like we can see just by this, like it's an open secret, right? Of how they view these communities and how they use them. Avi, you can take it from here, or I invite anybody else to join. Or if there are.
Or Apar, if you have a follow-up.
Yeah, no, I don't have any follow-ups. I'm also conscious of time. I want all of you, if you've already structured it, to please carry it along. I'll come back a little later. I do have certain points because I've read the essay 2 or 3 times. It's remarkable, but please go ahead and structure this amongst yourself.
So I think Vaishali sort of explained how this imposition of a myth of criminality was made on these communities. And that's precisely because colonial authorities didn't have enough resources to police the entire population, and they identified certain proper objects. And they had a criminal consensus of, who is likely to commit crimes, what kind of crimes they're likely to commit. And these ideas and the sort of consensus and the acceptance by like society of that kind of myth of criminality or narrative of criminality is entirely based off of the caste system. And so what's happened is that there is one type of community that has continuously been under the radar of the police. Now, the tech industry believes that it is helping the police by, introducing this idea of predictive policing. But if you really think about it, preventive policing, preventive surveillance, as well as predictive policing is something that the Indian police has practiced since its very inception, because it's already determined who is more or less likely to be a criminal, what kind of crimes they're likely to commit, where they're likely to commit these crimes, and how they're likely to commit these crimes. And what happens is, because there are either acts or regulations that allow the police to maintain records of habitual offenders, and the idea is to constantly keep them under surveillance so that these communities don't then outwit the police to commit crimes, but surprisingly, they do, according to the police, despite this overarching constant surveillance. They've been maintaining like physical registers with demographic details, as well as evidences of criminality. So demographic details is what is their age, what is their caste, what is their address, details about their personal lives. So who are their associates, who are their family members, what kind of material possessions do they possess? And evidences of criminality essentially being like the police's narratives of how this individual has their own specific modus operandi of committing crimes. And arguably the most important, sort of physical record that the police keep about habitual offenders is a very informal sort of checklist sort of sheet. And this is fiercely guarded, but we happen to see this in one of the police stations that we were sort of studying. Which is that there is a list of individuals who've been identified as habitual offenders, and there are fortnightly dates written on that record. And there is a police official who's been assigned to certain number of habitual offenders listed in that record. And the idea is that every time that the police have actually physically surveilled these individuals, apart from constantly seeking updates on them through mukhbirs, they have to sign and maintain a record and like sort of for their internal processing, just detail that they have in fact surveilled this individual and that they're aware of what this individual is planning to do next or what they have done in the past 15 days. And all of these registers until now have been maintained in physical copy. Now enter the CCTNS, right? Which is like the crime and criminal tracking networking system built by the union government. And the CCTNS is essentially like a platform that's been built so that police stations in every state can start digitizing all police records that pertain to a case, as well as other police records that they maintain. So the idea is, let us create this, you know, super platform, which also happens to be an opaque black box because it's accessible by only one branch of the government. And let's let's update all of these records, and let's also find ways to integrate them so that information can be easily shared between police stations that are in different jurisdictions. And when a specific file is pulled up on a specific individual, their entire quote-unquote criminal history is available to the officer that seeks information on that individual at the click of a button. So usually the documents that are uploaded on the CCTNS are the FIR, you know, documents related to evidence, as well as the final police record. Of course, the CCTNS as it exists is supposed to be a skeletal framework in the sense that state governments have, you know, the ability to build on the framework of the CCTNS to upload further documents and to also make sure that these documents are tied in an archipelago so that if there needs to be some cross-pollination of information, that is easily done, and to also be able to update new information. For instance, certain states are beginning to upload, you know, biometric information of quote-unquote criminals. These could be people who are merely suspects, or they could be convicts. So details about their fingerprints, details about their iris scans are also being uploaded by some states. And the idea is to use this sort of platform to begin a predictive analysis and a hotspotting of where crimes are likely to be committed and who is likely to commit these crimes. Now, the argument for building something like the CCTNS or uploading information on the CCTNS is that it's going to improve police efficiency. The sort of dominant narrative that the police always bring up is that they simply don't have either the manpower or the technological skills to keep up with societal advancements, and in their heads to also keep up with criminals who are using extremely sophisticated softwares to commit crimes. And that is a very profitable industry that is extremely enthusiastic and pliant in submitting you know, technologies to the police to build off of this CCTNS to actually do predictive policing in a far more insidious and pervasive manner in the digital realm than is allowed by the physical realm. Because in the physical realm, the sort of surveillance that happens is still your beat police officer, and it's not as easy to find all your all the information of an individual's engagement or interaction with the criminal justice system as such. And this technology is being introduced under the guise of efficiency, under the guise of objectivity, under the guise of neutrality. But because the police has maintained documents and records, especially when it comes to habitual offenders or quote-unquote gundas, primarily from members who belong to Vimukta Jatis and other marginalized communities, there is absolutely no way that any technology that is then used to process this information can come out with any kind of objective or neutral information. This is going to be information that is informed by caste biases of the police, and that further reifies and justifies caste biases by the police. And all of this is happening without any sort of legal framework or regulation of the breadth, scope, or use of information that is being collected.
Can I pose certain questions which are also coming in, which are very specific to this point right now? And it's up to you to take it up right now or take them as block a little later. The first is a small observation by me itself was that how the CCTNS also is being integrated or being sought to be integrated in phase three of digitization of the eCourts project, and whether that may entrench this level of surveillance both from the judicial as well as the policing institutions. And the second, which has come in, is that from YouTube, is it high time for police personnel in India to use body cams while detaining an individual? And are there any legal guidelines for stop and frisk procedures in India? I think these are broader questions, but please feel free to take them. If you can't take them right now, or the small comment which I made, I'll possibly bring them at a later point in time. I leave it to you as well as to Nikita and the others how to best decide it.
Nikita, would you like to take the first question and I can take the second?
Sure. Can we take the first question at a later point of time and, you know, respond to Apar's comment about the e-courts committee? Because I think it really draws from the CCTNS, right? And what the ICJS, which is the interoperable criminal justice system that it is, that the e-committee has proposed, is really this sort of integration of everything that was sort of left undesired or incomplete with the CCTNS, right? And it's one of the things that it does is with the CCTNS, it was still largely under the control of the institution of policing. But here now doors have opened for that sort of seamless exchange of data between the institution of policing, the prisons and the judiciary. And a risk of that also is that this is an extremely centralized sort of system that is sought to be housed out of the Ministry of Home Affairs, right? So now, like we're already in a system where accused persons don't know what is the kind of data that has been stored about them in police stations for years. And now, of course, a system is being proposed that allows for this data to be facilitated, right? So, and for this data to be transferred among various branches of the system. So then there is, like, it's almost like a sort of digitized version of the sealed envelope jurisprudence that the Supreme Court of India has put in place, right? Where an accused person is going to court, but the judge has access to all of this material, for instance, in a bail application, which they're relying upon to deny bail, which the accused person doesn't have access to. So, I mean, these are the sort of dangers of the way that ICJ is functioning, because as of now, at the level of the courts, this data is being used in a more tacit manner. You know, in the sense that when you go to court, when a judge reads the name Pardhi, you know, there is obviously that presumption of criminality. But of course, what one can predict might happen with these sort of recommendations is for that to happen in a more concerted manner.
The other questions which are coming in specifically to the CCTNS, which if we do want to cover right now, are voting choices also documented by the police for the registers and CCTNS? So are they able to in any way link voter data or voting preferences, even in, let's say, panchayati polls, to or they are able to infer that? Does it interfere with the choice for adult franchise in any way?
Sorry, Sujana, you want to go?
Yeah, as far as we know, there is no, at least, documentation of what habitual offenders or other, you know, people who are registered on the CCTNS, how they're voting or how, what their electoral preferences are being documented by the police, either in physical registers or then being updated onto the CCTNS. But I do want to say that how the policing system works is also that when there are electoral, decisions to be made by the citizens, in some instances, what happens is to limit people's electoral choices, the police engage in practices where they pick up entire members of communities, put them in jail for a few days, wait until the elections are over, and then release them. So that those kinds of practices do take place.
But there is also an extensive amount of information that is gathered by the police before elections, right? So we've seen this with both the MP assembly elections and the last general elections that happened, that there was this drive that was carried out in the entire city where the so-called habitual offenders were ushered into police stations in hordes. And there were these extensive questionnaires that the police sat with, which was really delving into, you know, really details like, "Achha, tum jail mein the, tumhari jail mein kiske saath dosti thi? Tumne motor gaadi kharidi, kitne ki kharidi?" So these really extensive questionnaires were being filled out by the police, and this is filled out routinely before elections. And like, this is obviously all happening, if you ask, which is the order or the rule that allows for the police to collect this information, you will get a standard answer saying, "Upar se order aaya hai, saab ka order aaya hai, so we have to collect this information." And then of course, right before elections, this sort of information also becomes the basis for what are known as externment orders, which means that I may be a voter in, say, Bhopal, but an externment order will be filed against, passed against me saying, "Oh, this person is a habitual offender and I will, and can cause disruption during elections, and therefore I will be stopped from entering Bhopal and adjacent districts for, say, a span of at least 6 months." So it means that ultimately my right to vote is also something that I'm deprived of because I can't enter those areas. And these externment orders aren't obviously like the categorization of habitual offenders themselves are rooted in convictions. It could just be that, you know, at some point I had pending cases, or even if I didn't have cases, even if I was acquitted in those matters, I can still be externed by the police, which is subsequently ratified by the magistrate before an election.
This is, Nikita, this seems a complete 360 degree. Sujana, it seems the complete lives itself are under sharp form of surveillance at all points in time. I think it gets a little much more scary when it goes digital, because the facility of the surveillance becomes much easier. And I see there are a lot of questions coming in. They are great questions. People are engaging with this conversation. But let's continue a bit more, I would guess.
I also want to add that the police have a vested interest in maintaining the idea of a habitual offender and the idea of a gunda. Because whenever the police fails, I mean, it's a very easy fallback option. Any kind of crime that happens that they're not quite able to pinpoint or get to the root of with respect to investigation, or there are some matters that they simply don't want to apply their minds to, it's very easy for them to just fall back on this image of a habitual offender being someone who continuously commits crimes, as habit, as a matter of habit. And it's a very easy fallback option. So the idea of a habitual offender is invoked by the police for a multiple range of cases, right from when there are shootouts happening, or when there are petty cases of theft, or even when in some instances when there are cyber crimes occurring, or when there are gender-based sexual violences. It's very easy for the police to just fall back on the idea of a habitual offender, go to specific basties, pick individuals who've been identified as a habitual offender, question them, and look like they're actually doing the work that they're supposed to be doing.
Reminds me of a quote in Ruth Bader Ginsburg's writing, in which she said that misquoting or allegory from Indian police constable, and I think this is a colonial tale, "It's way easier to rub chilies, red chilies in the eyes of the devil," something like that, rather than go out and question people. So procedure sometimes is not adhered to and has been a historical fault. But Please continue with your presentation, Nikita, you and your colleagues. I think we'll step towards digitization a bit more right now, given how we are pacing this. And there are a lot of great questions which are coming on CCTNS, Srijana. I'll come back to you on that as well. And Faishali as well, with respect to what you just presented.
I think at this point when when you speak more about Bhopalai as well, we've seen, you just have to go to the net to see habitual offenders DIG Bhopal, and there are statements he's very clearly made that we want to use technology to live track people and control habitual offenders. These are very like open statements made. So
I just want to get to the question of body cameras, because that sort of ties in really well to the next aspect of our paper, which is that there is a belief that with more surveillance, there will be a check on police impunity and that there will be greater police accountability. But how we're seeing that play on ground is not true. So there is a Supreme Court judgment that says that there needs to be cameras installed in every police station. And this judgment and this order specifically came out in order to check custodial violence within police stations. But we know that when instances of custodial violence actually happen within the premises of police stations, those feeds are never submitted in courts, even when they're challenged. And in fact, when we were interviewing community members, they said that there are specific rooms in the police station that have cameras. There is one specific room that doesn't have a camera. We're taken to the room that doesn't have the police camera, and then violence is committed on our bodies and on ourselves. We also know that even outside in our cities, when crimes happen, even if there is CCTV footage that may possibly exonerate an individual, because the police enjoy the discretion and the prosecution enjoys the discretion in introducing this footage as evidence, that courts may never realize that there is evidence that exists to exonerate individuals. For instance, in Khandwa MP in 2008, a Muslim man was accused of committing a crime under the cattle slaughter legislation. And where he was situated was within the range of a public CCTV camera. And his family kept insisting that let that camera footage be put in court, because this will help prove that the meat in question wasn't illegal meat as such. But the prosecution never introduced that evidence. And because the police also control what kind of evidence is presented, and they enjoy like a lot of power and discretion in deciding what kind of camera footage is then introduced. The family was unable to secure that footage, and they were unable to really bring it up in courts. And courts are also not insistent on asking for video evidence. And it's very interesting, because the police have really taken to the idea of introducing CCTVs and cameras everywhere. The overarching narrative is that we need CCTVs because we need to protect our national security, and we need to protect women from gender-based crimes that are committed. And up until now, there's been a strict separation between cameras that have been installed by the state that the police have access to and private cameras that the police request access from when a specific crime is committed. In Bhopal, we've seen a strange new hybrid come up. It's called Bhopal Eye. And it's obviously the brainchild of Bhopal's police. So what the Bhopal Eye is that it is a mobile application where any individual who has a private camera installed in their land or in their property is encouraged to feed in the coordinates of their camera into the app so that the police have a comprehensive network of all the private eyes, quote unquote, that they can access if crime is committed and they need footage. The worrying thing about Bhopal Eye is that in order to really push Bhopal Eye as a citizen policing initiative, the police have been going around to neighborhoods, to shops, to other private like establishments to quote unquote encourage individuals to install CCTV cameras and then log their coordinates into the app and to really create awareness about the benefits of a CCTV system as such. Now in states such as Telangana, there actually exist police regulations that require certain institutions, certain establishments to mandatorily install private cameras. The challenge with Bhopal Eye is that there is absolutely no regulation and there is no even like forget law, even like administrative regulation that mandates specific institutions or specific residential communities to install CCTVs. It is the police that wants to go on this awareness creation, a drive of encouraging people to install CCTV cameras everywhere. And how Bhopal Eye is used, how useful it's been, these are questions that we don't have answers to. Because, I mean, the way the Bhopal Eye is structured is also that information about how it is to be used and what its actual use is and what sort of legal regulation guards it is either unknown, even to senior police officers or to the people who've created this, whose brainchild it is, they're unwilling to share information with the public. And I mean, we also have to like recognize what kind of power the police have, right? If a police individual is going to come to an affluent society and say, why don't you install a CCTV camera? Or even to a low-income residential neighborhood and say, why don't you install a CCTV camera? It's very unlikely that people are not going to recognize the power differentials in that conversation, in that relationship, and not act on what the police's quote-unquote friendly advice is.
I'd like to go a little much more further in terms of what are the incentives also now. And it becomes a little much more important to understand about that. What can be the possible incentives for, I see immediately for the police to do it, but what are the incentives for these systems from, let's say, the bureaucracy or the government to be devised as well? And that poses a larger question of caste-based surveillance and digitization. And I hope in the next few slides or your presentation, you also go towards it.
Yeah. So the sort of rehearsed answer is that for the police and for the bureaucracy is that, well, technology makes policing more efficient, convenient, accessible, accurate, and, you know, reduces the sort of human bias, right? But I think it's important to, of course, one is the entire argument of, you know, the myth of neutrality of technology. But as you asked, Apar, you know, what is the incentive for bureaucrats, etc., to be delving into this? And I think it's very important to see that these are really driven by sort of neoliberal corporate interests, right? Because as Srujana was talking about Bhopal Eye, of course, Bhopal Eye is just one example, but there have been these numerous apps. If you go to, you know, if anybody has an Android phone, they go to Google Play Store, they just look at the sort of policing apps that exist. There will be these multiple apps designed by private corporations that produce surveillance technologies, right? So one of the companies called Honeywell, which is a company that has got the contract for really creating the sort of CCTV system in Bhopal. We interacted with some of their employees when we visited the CCTV room at the Bhopal Police's headquarters, right? Now, they got that contract because they did a really good job of surveilling the Kumbh Mela that had happened the year before they got that order. And that sort of partnership reveals like the two significant ways in which this sort of technology question and this digitization drive is being propelled, right? One is, of course, that there are these like private corporate interests that are casting this sort of like shadow of public good. So obviously, not only are they pulling the strings, but like they're also sort of like really setting the stage for it, right? And it also has some really like wide-ranging implications for the relationship of people with the state and how now the state is coming to view its citizens, right? So when we were talking to one of the police officers for our interviews, he said he referred to the population of Bhopal as clients. And that language to us is very interesting because that language is like a clear, you know, depiction of that this is clearly like a rights-based question has now turned into like a sort of like customer service approach, right? So it's really these sort of interests. I mean, we've seen this in Surat with Nippon. We've seen this, you know, with like this sort of safe cities sort of facial recognition of which is an integral component. Like these sort of campaigns being run by various private industries. And of course, like one is that, you know, we want to be able to make policing more efficient, but in a more sort of like principled sense, it's ultimately that we want to make sure that there is self-discipline, right? So we're constantly creating this sort of like, you know, panopticon view, which is that you feel, you know, that you're constantly being watched. Therefore, you regulate your own behavior. And that is what we're seeing that is happening. And it's important to see what kind of behaviors that are being regulated and what are the lines on which this discipline is also being enforced, right? It is, of course, then it goes back to the caste question, because who are these people that are considered to be indisciplined and who are these people that the police thinks deserve to be controlled are obviously people who are outliers within the caste system. So it is really that sort of disciplining that is required to be done, right? Like, a couple of months ago, there was a proposal by Lucknow police where they said, you know, we want to introduce these facial recognition systems so that if women are in distress, then, you know, the police will be able to go there and the police will be able to, you know, respond to a situation like that, right? And like these sort of artificial intelligence technology systems and the way that policing functions is that there is that over-representation of certain communities. So what is this AI system going to do? It's going to eventually incriminate men who belong to a certain section of the population, right? Because, I mean, all of us who have applied our minds to questions of sexual violence, sexual harassment, know that a majority of these instances stem in the intimate interpersonal space, right? But what this sort of AI-driven women safety campaign does is to say that the bad man is always a stranger, and who is this stranger is also a stranger who belongs to a certain caste, class, category, right? So you're really creating these typologies of what a criminal looks like and what kind of people commit certain kinds of crimes, right? So it's really like creating those sort of typologies and regulating that sort of like self-discipline, which is what this is driven by, and it's entirely propelled by, you know, these sort of corporate interests, which obviously has assumed the facade of, you know, technological efficiency and technological efficiency driven crime control.
So in a sense, caste will perpetuate and embed within technology in several ways through surveillance. Nikita. And this is not a hypothesis, but actually a felt reality. Not only.
Absolutely. Because, I mean, it goes back to one of the questions that was being asked, right? Which is that, like, the CCTV on paper, CCTNS system on paper is a system which is supposed to make documents, FIRs, charge sheets, etc., accessible to people, right? But what that skeleton is being used for is to really now digitize and build upon that to really like store fingerprints, store biometric data, which is a direct digitization of the sort of data that exists in police stations about the so-called habitual offenders, right? So we've seen that happen. We've seen surveillance being increased in these areas, and we've seen that, you know, this is the way that predictive policing is being carried out. And so this is why we're saying this in the paper, in our essay also, that but what we're seeing is actually the emergence of a parallel digital caste system. This is what it's doing. I mean, we've seen like analogies of this and really how detrimental it can be to marginalized communities in the context of the US, right? Where so much work has happened around race and technology, and we're really now seeing that being played out in India, and it's going to be far more complex because the institution of caste and the way that different kinds of caste-based targeting operates is also far more complex. So it's really that what we're seeing is the emergence of a parallel digital caste system, and whether it's the CCTNS or whether it's the ICJS, it's really the laying down the foundation stone of that digital caste system.
I just want to quickly go to Vaishali as well, because it's very important to also understand what is the actual perception and feedback of the communities as well who are witnessing all this technology come in. And what has been your survey and your perception when you do talk to them?
So in our interviews, when we asked, there was a very interesting... See, first of all, when they said, haan, fingerprints pehle bhi lete the. You know, and as we have seen, they used to put their fingerprints on paper, and abhi bhi lete hain with Aadhaar machine se lete hain. These are the kind of things. So for them, their realities haven't changed, right? So that is one thing. And one interesting comment came that hum to chahte hain laga de cameras, because at least they'll come to see that we didn't commit the crime, you know. So which goes back to again what Shrujana mentioned, that it's absolutely at the discretion of the police. And I'd like to highlight one more incident over here. I mean, it's a practice that they're very careful when they drag people to the police station, that they take them to the rooms where the cameras are not working or are not there, you know. So it's not like this is going to change anything, and they're also very aware of it. So this is what we've come across so far. And the idea that the cameras is going to help them, prove their innocence is also coming from this limited imagination of security that we have, and the constant bombarding that we are also being told that CCTVs are good for you. And, these are eyes for your safety, like that sort of constant messaging that goes on. And like the posters and all are from Facebook. So they're really like going to town with these messaging, right? Like with everywhere. So of course, even when people are imagining how they can be protected in the system, they're imagining within this limited space of technology. So this is what we've come across so far. Avneendra, would you like to
also
add?
To add to Vaishali's, actually, with one of the interviews that we had with a member of the Irani Muslim community here, where a lady recounted an incident where a young man was called to the police station, and the police insisted that he was a habitual criminal, that there were several cases against him, and that's why he needed to be detained. Now, she said, and I kept insisting to the policeman to just put in his name, just put in his Aadhaar ID into the computer and see if he has cases, because he has none. And the police would just refuse to do it. Like, they did not, it was up to them to see if this guy was popping up on the system or if his name was in the records. But they decided not to look in the system. So the idea that this would in some ways aid the members of the communities in negotiating with the police is sort of is naive, because ultimately the power differential and the control remains with the police as to what they want to do with the technology, right? It's not that the technology magically sort of erases that that sort of asymmetry. And therefore, it's it is, I mean, it is something that perpetuates the sort of inequity not corrected or sort of level it out.
Thank you so much. Now, I'd like to also come to, has there been any kind of discussion in wider civil society or in spaces in Madhya Pradesh specifically with respect to what's been happening? Or do you think this is limited to Madhya Pradesh? Or if you can prescribe as well, and I don't know if, given that your field of study is very, 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 very well focused and defined, do you anticipate this happening in other states as well? Because the, it seems to be the same digital architecture, the same institution of caste, which will be possibly interacting in several other environments across India, given that this the digitization process is similarly ongoing on a national level. So do you think there is need for further study and development around this? Just how racial policing has become a big issue in the United States, this also needs to be picked up. So what is the future as researchers, as you look towards this project, towards advancing social justice?
Rajana, go for it. You're on mute. You're on mute.
Right. To answer your question about, of course, we've seen like the ways in which the CCTNS is being used in Madhya Pradesh. But our understanding is that Madhya Pradesh is actually lagging behind certain states in its very huge ambitions and aspirations to create 360-degree profiles of citizens and to particularly be able to surveil individuals as well as, map hotspots where crimes are being committed. States such as Telangana are in the process of creating these integrated hubs that are supposed to be multi-story data centers that will be storing like information about every single individual and complete 360-degree information, as the police like to say. And you know, the idea is simply to be able to ape Telangana, which itself is aspiring to have the same technological prowess as is currently with police in Western states such as the US and the UK, right? The idea is, hey, police in London have XYZ technologies, why don't we also have these specific tools at hand? We know that there are several states that are trying to use different kinds of technologies to then surveil individuals, like Nikita mentioned a few. And it's very interesting. In India, we were aware that the sort of algorithmic-based, apparently neutral objective policing that's happened in Western countries has disproportionately targeted Black and brown communities and immigrant communities. And despite those conversations actually raising very important points about disproportionate targeting of communities, raising questions about privacy, raising questions about the extent of state surveillance, none of that conversation has like actually happened in India with respect to how it plays out in our social stratification. Our social stratification is also not as simple as that in the West, where there is like a clearer hierarchy and clearer understanding of who is always, enjoying specific powers and on whose body specific powers are being enjoyed. Caste is a ladder, and it's also got its own local intricacies. It's got its own nuances in specific jurisdictions and specific locales. So it's not a simple question of community A then enjoying community power over community B, right? Because ours is a ladder with much more complex, with first of all, far more subcaste groups, very specific local nuances, with like communities not even falling within the caste system as such at all, but still being subject to extensive surveillance, right? For instance, the Vimukta Jatis, they don't fall or identify with the caste system at all, but that doesn't mean that in any way they are not suffering from the injustice of the caste system. In fact, they're suffering perhaps more than other groups are. And so there needs to be a bigger conversation. And I'd just like to add that even with policing and surveillance, the discussion is always about how do we check these practices of the police, how do we curb the sort of intrusions that the police is making. But like the fundamental conversation is why, what is the logic and the institution on which the police is doing its work? And that is the caste system, that is the caste rationale. And so the idea of, say, data protection or privacy or surveillance also needs to understand the caste system and the way in which it works and center that if the idea is to really bring about any kind of police accountability.
Thanks. And I think we, at least when I say we, I mean at IFF or our community, especially in the tech policy communities, we've just started dealing with these questions. And here, Nikita, the core question which comes across, and I want to deal with it very honestly as well, but also recognizing our own caste privilege, is that our communities, my communities of tech policy, of policy and governance are also inhabited by so many people of privilege, including me. What are things we can do besides initiating these conversations, which may actually lead to a much more equitable distribution, and which also speaks to why this paper seems so novel? It shouldn't, right? And it's taken so much time, and I shouldn't be verbalizing them just because I know English, but I would like all of you to also use this opportunity a bit to let us know. Because I think a lot of people who are attending this genuinely have good intent and would like to cede space, would like to step back, and would like to know what to do.
Yeah. I think this is an important question, Apar, because there is so much conversation in the tech and policy space around digital divide, right? And that's sort of like a keyword or a buzzword that's so prominent. I think it's important to, you know, turn that gaze within and see what is the digital divide within the tech and policy space itself, right? Who are these communities that are accessing the internet? Who are these communities that are at the receiving end of the various problems that come with technology? And who are the people that are working on these questions, right? Because there is a clear disparity between who are the recipients of, primarily the recipients of these issues, and who are members of organizations or leading organizations in these spaces, right? And I think, of course, there is that question of representation, but I think it's also, like you were saying, you know, about ceding space, and that's a very important point, because I think it's also important now to move beyond the question of representation alone to the question of redistribution, right? Because we're ultimately looking at material changes emerging within these spaces, right? And I think just very quickly, I want to talk about why caste is central to that question, because, you know, we have a lot of D&I policies and these D&I trainings, etc., that are conducted in organizations and really all very well-meaningly done. But like the question of caste is included alongside like a horizontal list of variables, right? But for those of us, and this is not just within the tech space, but doing any kind of work within the Indian subcontinent, I think it's important to see questions of gender, sexuality, disability within the caste system, rooted within the institution of caste, right? Because that is the genesis of power. So I think a big, first really good starting point for organizations is one, to be able to invest in really thinking about what an anti-caste framework would look like. And in that regard, I think a first step is the step of having affirmative action, not just in hiring, but also in salaries and promotions, right? Because, you know, it's great. It's a great first step to hire people from Bahujan communities. But I think it's also important that, you know, in the way that organizational hierarchies are structured, that at every level, particularly in leadership responsibilities, you have people from these communities, right? Because, well, we do a great job of hiring people at the initial stage, but it's important to see who is ultimately responsible for decision making, who has financial powers, who signs the checks, who enters into conversations with donors, policy stakeholders, etc., right? And that sort of representation there is absolutely unilateral, because you only see people from a certain caste, class, background that are overrepresented in that space, right? So I think it's also important to see how, you know, it's important to see how leadership is ultimately facilitated from within these communities, and that these are people who are in positions of key decision making, right? And it's also important because, especially for those of us who are doing social justice work of any kind, I think it's important to recognize that there is, of course, that one aspect of lived experience which people from these communities are bringing to their work, but there is also the other aspect of the sort of precarity, right? Because anybody who's doing this work is obviously operating from a certain point of having assumed certain kinds of risks, but who is, like, what kind of risks people are assuming and how precarious they are to them is obviously something that differentiates from, you know, differs from one person to another depending on their social location. And that's something that needs to be taken into account. And I think it's something that an organization, anybody who's setting up on as an organization, it needs to be a fundamental principle, right? Like, it's because so far you don't see that being a part of the ethos of organizations, you know, building leadership, facilitating leadership, and really ceding power and space, right? And having that sort of like anti-caste and intersectional understanding also means that it reflects in the way that existing policies function. So for instance, POSH, right? Like since Vishakha, since the 2013 law, we all have ICCs, it's great. But why aren't we pushing ourselves to think about the fact that women are not a homogenous category, right? That there are also Bahujan women who are precarious and particularly more precarious within the labor force. So why is our understanding of sexual harassment at the workplace not inclusive of that precarity that women from marginalized communities come with? Why does the ICC composition not reflect that? So I think once that sort of, it becomes a part of your framework, then it's something that has to translate in policies, in hiring, in wages, in the way that leadership responsibilities are handed out, right? And I think, you know, when you said, Apar, like at the beginning, that, you know, this shouldn't be novel. For us, when we were working on this and when this essay was going to be published, like a primary anxiety was that, you know, it would be dismissed as a piece of writing that is dealing with an ancillary question. So, and of course, like the anxiety was rooted in the fact that the question of caste is not a part of, it's at best a lens. It's not our understanding of power. It doesn't shape our understanding of power. You know, we still use like terms like poor and terms like marginalized in a very unqualified manner. I mean, of course, there has been some useful comparative lens that we have relied upon, especially with the sort of race and tech work that's happening in the US. But I mean, that is still like it's very, very limited. And I think there is a lot of work that needs to be done in really like fleshing out what these systems of power mean within our lives and how do we see questions of technology, law and policy operating within that. And I think that's something that requires
Nikita, sorry. We have 10 minutes. So just to budget, I'll just do two things here.
The first thing
I'll do is I'll acknowledge our own privilege at IFF and what we are doing a bit. So our board composes of four men, which includes me and one woman. All of us happen to be upper caste. We come from the Save the Internet movement. And when it was happening also, it was entirely, more often than not, there were 90% men there. We didn't have awareness at that point in time. And I know this is far from perfect given our present understanding. I would not like to comment publicly by when will we be able to do better, but I would like to do better and I would like to signal that intent. much more immediate steps can be taken towards us in terms of hiring as well. I will try to do that. But what can people do who are tuning into this podcast is rather than supporting IFF, which has these resources, is to support organizations which are coming up, which are organizations of today, which have this awareness and can bring this diversity. And one such organization is actually being formed, which will do this work, in which the authors are a part. I think I will leave it to Nikita to explain a little more how she's going about organizational development. And then I have one final question about racial-based surveillance and caste-based surveillance, which I'm inquisitive about. I'm so sorry, but I'm eating into that time.
No, so we work with what is known as the Criminal Justice and Police Accountability Project, as Vaishali flagged earlier. This is an organization that is rooted in anti-caste values, and it has been co-founded by someone, by me, who I belong to the Dalit community. And the work that we do is really questioning this sort of underpinnings of the criminal justice system, right? Particularly, we work with communities that we've been talking about today, that are the Vimukta communities. We are lawyers. We do litigation work and we do research work. And for us, we're very cognizant of the fact that while we're doing this work, at this point, within our full-time staff composition, there is nobody from the Vimukta communities themselves who are working with the CPA project. So the larger goal is for this to be an organization or a space that is led and managed by people from the community, and to see how those of us who are occupying existing leadership positions within the organization can make for that leadership, and to really cultivate in building that leadership, right? So for us, the research work and the litigation work and, you know, building this leadership is as responsible as and as important as the research work and the litigation work that we do, right? And that is something that informs the way in which the organization has been set up. And it's, we are very, very cognizant of the fact that even within marginalized communities, there are differential levels of power and differential levels of marginalities that people occupy. And it's something that informs the work that we do. And it's something that informs our understanding of the question of law itself, right? Because I think in the way, and, you know, to answer your second question, Apar, which is about race and caste, is there is a lot of...
Hold on, Nikita. Yeah. How do people support you?
People can support us. We, at this point, have a bail fund. It's a community bail fund, because one of the biggest problems with the criminal justice system is the fact that people are struggling to secure their liberty through because they don't have the assets to furnish bail, right? So we have a community bail fund that we've set up, which means that any sort of contributions that are made to the community bail fund are then used for various people from marginalized communities who are unable to furnish bails for themselves. And also the litigation work and the research work that we do is largely supported by various donors. So to contribute to that work so that we can continue doing the sort of research and the litigation work that we have been doing so far.
And Nikita, how do I practically access? Is there a link? Can you share it with me? We'd love to circulate it at the
So we don't have a link yet. We're a nascent organization. So we're in the process of figuring. Yeah, so there are pledges that can be made to cpaprojectindia@gmail.com. Yes. We will be setting up these processes very soon. But in the meanwhile, these pledges can be made to cpaprojectindia@gmail.com. We will also be circulating more information once we have a donation link, etc., on our Twitter handle, Instagram handle, and our website.
Nikita, I'm sure many people from the IFF community are well aware as to the not only dearth of diversity, but also the excellent work you're doing. It's well-needed work. It needs to grow, okay? So we'll do our best towards supporting it. But the last question remains.
Yeah.
and it comes from a sense of academic curiosity, because we see so much written about, not so much, it's well deserved, in terms of racial based discrimination. Does it have parallels with caste based discrimination, or am I, that's a very simplistic understanding I'm coming with.
I mean, it has parallel to the extent that race forms the basis of the way that criminal profiling, policing, and, you know, other policing functions that are now digitized are carried out in the US, right? I think that is the beginning and the end of that parallel, because the question of caste in itself is a more complex question. So, for instance, the way that the sort of targeting of Vimuktas is carried out, that method of targeting will differ if it's a Muslim community, right? The laws that they're targeted under will differ. So there are, I mean, at this point with caste, we're at a place where it's not just that we don't have the sort of disaggregated data in terms of, you know, our NCRB data, the existing databases that exist to see, okay, we have SC, ST, OBC categories, which are these really broad-based administrative categories, but which are the communities that are overrepresented within those categories. But we are also a country that hasn't had caste census data that we've had access to since 1931. In 2011, there was a caste census that was carried out. It's been a decade. We don't have access to that data. So there is really, there are several communities that have been wrongfully classified. The Pardhi community that we've referred to repeatedly today are communities that are put in the general category in the district of Bhopal and several other districts of Madhya Pradesh, which means that there is no benefit of affirmative action. There's no safeguarding of Atrocities Act and really other welfare schemes that the government has for these communities, right? So we are really operating at a standpoint where we don't even understand the full extent of the system that we are dealing with, and a system that continues to play out in multiple ways. I think a useful way to see from the US example is to really be able to delve into this system in itself and delve into the complexities of it, because that it's only when we're able to accurately diagnose the problem and call it what it is, if that we will be able to see what are the ramifications and the various ways in which it's manifesting.
Nikita, I also think you've just started, but this is a wonderful team you have.
Yeah.
All of you are young, know about this in such a deep way. You're passionate about this area, and I'm sure you'll find the support which is well needed. Please carry on writing. There's incredible power in it, and it brings something unique, and to my regret, it is unique to the tech policy sector at present. We'll do our best at IFF. We'll also encourage other organizations and our community to keep supporting you. As shared, this is a nascent organization. We all need to come together and support them. They have yet to set up completely what can be done at present. Our pledges can be made. There's an email address we'll share in the on our social media right now, as well as on the YouTube live stream recording. And I request you to kindly consider open a conversation with them and explore how can you support them. This has been just one of many starting conversations for us as well, and we hope this actually allows us a degree of honest introspection, as well as seeding space, which is very necessary given how unrepresentative tech policy is today. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Apar, for having us. Thank you so much to everyone at IFF for, you know, taking cognizance of this writing and also organizing this discussion around it. I hope a few years down the line, when we're discussing these issues, we will be at a much better place and will definitely have done more work in terms of both questions of redistribution and applying our minds to how these questions play out in the lives of different people.
One final question.
Yeah.
When is the next piece of writing coming out?
Next piece of writing will be out very soon, in the next month and a half. This will be around the Excise Act and just generally looking at how the alcohol regime in this country is carried out, and that's what we will be doing next, and hopefully that will be out in the next 1 month 45 days.
looking forward to it. Have a wonderful weekend, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.